Well, Australia's had some pretty iconic global women touring our shores to open up 2024, but I'm very pleased to say one of our own has also been touring, not belting out tunes, but books. Kathy Lette has long been reading the room on female stories and what is going on right about now. And she's done it with this one, Lee, which you should be a little bit afraid of, The Revenge Club. Oh. And Kathy joins us now. Hello.
Hi, Lee. Hi, Vic. So nice to see you again. Have a bit of girl talk.
Yeah. What a time for you to be in Australia, Kathy, when there are so many amazing women out here right now.
Oh, fantastic. I saw Pink concert and I saw Taylor Swift. And I'll tell you what I loved about Taylor Swift last night was the estrogen. It was just like, you know, it was 80,000 people, nearly all female. And you just feel this sea of sequined estrogen washing over you, and it was a beautiful thing. And of course, she's all about female friendship, as am I. Mm. You know, I always say that women are each other's human wonder bras, uplifting, supportive, and making each other look bigger and better. And Lee, I'm wearing a wonder bra right now, and it's called that because when you take it off, you wonder where the hell your breasts went. So, you know, never wonder where your female friends have gone. Hold them close. Let cups runneth over with love for your female friends.
And you will be blushing.
I will. I'm already blushing.
By the end. Absolutely. I said it off the top, Kathy, you have been telling female stories since the beginning of time, and you just always know what people need at that time. And I love you've dedicated the Revenge Club to your sisters, to your mum, to great women. But Lee, I'd like you to read that line there.
Oh,
thanks.
My eyes. No men were harmed in the making of this book. Well, only a couple of misogynistic, and they totally bloody well deserved it.
They totally bloody well did deserve it, because everything in that book actually is taken, all the misogyny is taken from real life. I mean, things that happened to me, all my girlfriends, or things I read about in the papers. So, you know, it is still a man's world. It's as you know, 100 years since the suffragettes tied themselves to the railings, and we still don't have equal pay. You know, we're still getting concussion hitting our head on the glass ceiling, and we're supposed to clean it while we're up there, Lee. So, you know, any woman who calls herself a post-feminist has kept her wonder bra and burnt her brains, because we've still got a long way to go. So I think until we get equal pay, I'm allowed to comedically kneecap the misogynists of this world. Not you, Lee, obviously.
No, of course not. Yeah, you know, I'm very, very
You've
modern.
Evolved. And
evolved.
Evolved. He is.
In some
Actually,
places I am. But
there is a very fabulous line about that glass ceiling in your book, and it's a wonderful coming together. I know you are still so close to so many of your original friends, your waybacks, and that's a little bit how this story begins.
Yeah, it starts with four girlfriends who they were very close at university, and they haven't seen each other since then. We don't quite know why. It's a bit of a mystery that gets solved later in the book. But one of them's been living in America, and she's coming back to London, and she wants to get all these girls together. So, you know, they haven't seen each other for 30 years, and they're all a bit trepidatious. But as soon as they meet, you know how it is with your girlfriends, Vic. You just pick up where you left off. They're laughing and talking. Three of them are there waiting for this fourth friend, and she's been working in Hollywood on special effects movies for a long time. Anyway, but then this man comes and sits down at their table, and they're like, oh, you can't sit there. We're expecting our girlfriend. And he's like, yeah, I know. You're expecting Joe Logan. And they're like, really suspicious. They're like, is he a stalker? What is he? How does he know? And we're like, how do you know that? And he goes, well, I'm Joe. And they're like, oh, my God. First of all, they think that their friend's transitioned. But then she tells the story that she got the sack in her job in Hollywood for being a menopausal hot mess. So she was so angry, she just went home and turned herself into a man, went back to the same job, got a promotion and a pay rise. And she's like, in a man's world, it's just so much better to be a man. So she's kind of kept up this masquerade, like Mr. Doubtfire, living as a bloke. And her girlfriends are like, you're wrong. There's never been a better time to be a woman. You know, and then that week we see something really bad happen to all three of them in their careers. They get sacked or passed over by their husbands or whatever because they've passed their amuse-by date. So the next time they meet, they're like, you were so right. And that's when they form the Revenge Club, because now they've got a secret weapon, because Joe can get into the men's room.
Mm.
So it's a revenge romp, and women love revenge because, I mean, it's really sweet, totally non-fattening, fabulous.
That's my favourite line. <They're just non-fattening.
laughs> So they're kind of in cahoots then, getting their own back on these misogynistic rat bags. So it's I mean, I wrote it. It's funny. I hope it made you laugh, did it, Vic?
Oh, absolutely. And I love the amuse-by date because it's so right in so many ways. And I really love the four characters all have very... They're celebrated women. They've had amazing careers. And I feel like you grabbed something from each of them. You experienced each of them.
Totally. I mean, one of them works in television, which I did as well. One of them is a writer. Well, I know that inside out. The other one is an actress. I've never been an actress, but I have a lot of female friends who are in that profession, and they've been so sidelined as they get older. And our character, our actress character, she gave up. She was very famous, but she gave up acting to raise her children. And now they've left the nest. She wants to go back into the acting world, but she's got such high hopes. She'll be working with Emerald Fennell and, you know, all these wonderful female directors. But the only thing she gets offered is an ad for vaginal dryness because of her age. So, you know, it's a shock to all of them. And then of course, the one who's in television, she thinks she's going prime time with her political show, but they only take the bloke and not her because she made the terrible, she had the terrible audacity to put a picture of herself on Instagram with grey hair and no makeup. So she seemed to be kind of aging the brand. So this is the sexism that women face every single day, this ageist sexism. And I really wanted to address it because I've talked about the menopause. The menopause has kind of lost the taboo now. People are talking about it. But the next great hurdle for women is this ageist sexism. For example, in the television industry, 85% of people on television over 50 in Australia and Britain are men, 85%. So women, you get one wrinkle and you're put out to career pasture. You know, so we never see ourselves reflected on screens, and what you can't be what you can't see kind of thing. So I wanted to just blow a big literary raspberry at that. And also say to women, there's nothing wrong with aging. I mean, it's better than the alternative, right? Yeah. And also, it can be the best time of your life. You know, post-menopause, no periods, no pregnancy scares, got all that tampon money to spend. And you should just go forth and be fabulous, you know? So I really want to cheer women up about that.
I love that the revenge is quite elegant. I mean, every little piece is so well planned out, and you really have thought it through, haven't you?
I've fantasised about it many times, that's for sure.
Kathy, have you acted in the past with revenge at all? Have you always taken the higher ground in your real life? Like, as it wind back the clock 20 years, maybe last year, have you taken part in a sweet little revenge?
Well, being a writer, of course, a lot of writers, you say, why do you write? And they say, oh, for the artistic freedom, and oh, for the joy of creativity and stuff. No, it's revenge, you know. You can impale an enemy on the end of your pen. And poetic justice is the only true justice in the world. And I say that having been married to a lawyer for 28 years. You can shish kebab, you know, someone who's put you down or belittled you or whatever, and it gives you great satisfaction and great
because
power.
Because all you really need to do, I suppose, is put the right sort of car in or the right liquor or the, you know, the right thing, and that person will know it's them, right?
Totally. Although it's really interesting because most, if they are sort of narcissistic, psychopathic type blokes, they never think they're anyone unattractive. They always think they're the hero. So you can get away with it as well.
Now, you've been writing for a long time. Has your writing style obviously changed and evolved over the years, but is the same issue still coming up as well?
Sadly, yes, it is still that women are second-class citizens, you know. And also, God is even a bloke. I mean, think of all the things women go through. From when you're a teenager and you first get taken hostage by your hormones once a month, and then there's pregnancy where everything swells to sumo wrestler proportions. You know, then there's childbirth where you stretch a birth canal the customary, what would you say, 5 kilometres. Then there's mastitis, then there's the menopause, and then just when everything goes quiet, of course, you grow a beard. I mean, how can that be fair? I mean, I could make like a macrame hanging basket arrangement, what's going on here. So, you know, God is definitely a bloke. And then we have all the sexism in the workplace, and then we have the sexism at home, because women have a second glass ceiling at home, the domestic glass ceiling. So, because even though we make up 50% of the workforce, I'd still say we're doing about 99.9% of all the housework and all the childcare. Not you, of course, Lee, because we've said you've evolved.
I'm evolved,
and also,
man.
And also, you know, it's in men's interest to do more housework because, I mean, it's scientifically proven that no woman ever shot her husband while he was vacuuming. So, you know,
I do love that you always sneak facts and figures into your books as well, don't you? Like, you talk in the book about single men, you know, single men live shorter lives, single women live longer lives. Like, you give us lots of facts.
Yeah, because I do write a lot of journalism too. I've got a column in the Sunday Times in London. I've got a column in the Sydney Morning Herald. I've got a column in A Woman at Home, Britain's biggest selling magazine for women. So I am always on the sniff for material and researching things. So I think if you ground your comedy in reality, it makes it so much more powerful. And also, as you said earlier, I always just write the book I wish I'd had when I was going through something. So whether it was as a teenager with puberty blues, saying to the other surfy girls, you are more than just a life support system to a pair of breasts. You know, whether it's when, as a single girl in Sydney, you know, saying to other girls that, you know, most of the blokes think monogamy is something you make dining room tables out of, be careful. You know, even if I'm talking about motherhood or raising a teenage daughter or raising an autistic son, which I've done, divorce, menopause, I'm always like, girls, this is what I learnt. This might help you and give you a laugh on the way. Mm. So, yeah, I think that's the other reason that I write.
And you would have readers, women particularly, who've been with you on the journey since Puberty Blues, that have travelled with you each book and you've been there for that part of their life.
Yeah. And also, they're the most fabulous females. It's so flattering. You know, when I go on book tour, I'm on book tour now, and I meet my beautiful readers. They're just the most witty, wise and wonderful women. You just want to go on a girls' night out with all of them. My male friends like you, Lee, very funny. They have what I call the black belt in tongue foo, where they just fire off one-liners. But women never tell set jokes, do we, Vic? We tend to just, our humour's confessional, cathartic, self-deprecating, very funny, but very honest.
I feel like every time somebody...
It's intelligent humour as
opposed
to our
humour.
Yeah,
and I feel like when your friends were with you, they'd be trying to remember all of those clever lines because you are able to just turn them out all the time. And is there always a new one ready to go? Is your next story already percolating around in your head?
You mean who I want to have revenge on?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, I always have books going around in my head. But also, you know, my women friends are very funny. Like, if we were on a girls' night out now, you'd be having me in stitches, roaring with laughter. Because, you know, that's what we do for each other. And that's the human wonder bras. And that's what I love. And if I have any gift as a writer at all, I think it's writing down, putting down on paper, the way women talk when there's no men around. And it is very funny, very honest and disarming. I try and write with humour because I think if you disarm with charm, you've got a better chance of getting your kind of feminist message in there.
And you know what it does make you do as well? Because you are doing exactly that. When you're reading, you find yourself flying through it because you feel like you're part of the conversation.
That's fabulous. I mean, that's the best review you could ever give me. To make you feel that you're in the story. So that I try and keep it really pacey and funny, but with heart. I mean, you can have wit, but you have to have grit, and you have to have a bit of honesty and pathos as well. So I try and, yeah, it's like a fabulous souffle of...
Did you have a favourite in the Revenge Club? Is any of those ladies particularly your favourite?
Well, of course, the writer, Matilda, is my favourite. She's Aussie.
Yep.
And also, you know, I went through what she went through recently. In the book, because she's a middle-aged female writer, her agent and her publisher say, oh, nobody wants to read books about middle-aged women. And that did happen to me a couple of years ago in London. My agent died and I got a new agent who didn't believe in me at all and said, nobody wants to read these stories about middle-aged women. It's just not sexy. And I thought, oh, gosh, maybe I have passed my amuse-by date. And I was kind of crushed for a while. And then I thought, I've never been that wrong before with any of my books. And I said, I was like, stick with your instinct, because who reads books? Middle-aged women, you know? I think we need a new genre. I don't think we can call it... I hate the term chick lit.
Me too.
I hate it. It's so demeaning. And so I thought, well, what's a good... And I can't, even though I kind of invented the genre with Puberty Blues and Girls' Night Out and all of those books... So, and then I kind of invented mummy lit with mad cows, etc. So I thought, well, what would the new genre be? And I thought, well, what do women my age, what are we like? Well, first of all, when you turn 50, you guys are too young, but you get a kind of, oh, screw it, I'm 50 gene kicks in, where you think, if not now, when? Like, you just want to carpe the hell out of Diem. So I just thought, should just call it, I don't give a shit lit.
I like that.
Oh, I love that.
That's it. That's a new genre.
Yeah.
It is.
I don't give a shit lit. Yes. It works for me.
It's absolutely perfect. I cannot imagine there will ever be a time when people aren't loving, devouring your books, Kathy Lette. Thank you so much for chatting with us today and congratulations on the Revenge Club.
Oh, you are both so generous. And how are you going, Lee?
I'm
are
doing
you
all right. I'm all right. I've
not ovulating yet.
Estrogen levels are kicking in and I just want to get invited to one of your parties, that's all. Your girlfriend parties.
You have a lot of fun.
I'll dress up as a girl and go incognito.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Oh, well, yeah. He could try.
He's got great lashes. I think it'll work. Thank you, Kathy.
See you, Kathy.
Thank you for that lovely, generous chat as well. You were so kind about the book. It means a lot to me.
Oh, it's a lot of fun. Thank you, Kathy.